Good morning. Blessings, everyone, and welcome to Mount Pleasant Church. This week, we've all been shocked and saddened by the turn of events that we witness in Afghanistan. The whole of the world's eyes have been on the situation, and everybody will be just feeling devastated by what we see and hear and what is likely to come in the weeks and years of the future for that country. We feel sometimes helpless in a situation like this, but we are not helpless. There is so much we can do. Christians throughout the entire world must just be brought to their knees to pray for this situation and pray for all involved in situations of persecution everywhere across the world. So I'd like to just us to just bow our heads in prayer and pray for these people. This morning, Lord, we just thank you that we are able to meet to worship you, praise you, and turn our thoughts to the situation across the world in which so many people are unable to do this. The plight and persecution of people in Afghanistan and many other populations in many countries is heartbreaking. But Lord, we are well placed to do so much to help by praying in earnest. We must pray daily, fervently, pray together, alone, silently, or out loud, for your protection, for provision for these people, for peace, for comfort, and for shelter. Lord, we pray for all the leaders and citizens around the world who are watching to be emboldened and do all in their powers to assist those who are being persecuted. We pray for those who are persecuting others, that they themselves will have a miraculous encounter with you, Lord, that they will be saved. And we know, Lord, that you can answer this prayer when we consider Saul, the zealous persecutor whose miraculous encounter with you changed him to Paul, the apostle. We see in our Christian brothers and sisters, we see our Christian brothers and sisters being persecuted, and we are called to respond. We're God's hands and feet on this earth. And blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Dear Lord, in this spiritual conflict, we're reminded of what you teach us. We pray all the time and ask God for anything in line with the Holy Spirit's wishes. Plead with him, reminding him of your needs, and keep praying earnestly for all Christians everywhere. I'd like to also just read to you Ephesians 3, verse 14 to 19. And this should be our response to what we see. We know that we can do something to make a difference. My response is to get down on my knees before the Father, this magnificent Father who parcels out all heaven and earth. I ask him to strengthen you by his Spirit, not a brute strength, but a glorious inner strength, that Christ will live in you as you open the door and invite him in. I ask him that with both feet planted firmly on love, you'll be able to take in with all followers of Jesus the extravagant dimensions of Christ's love. Reach out and experience the breadth, test its length, plumb the depths and rise to the heights. Live full lives, full in the fullness of God. Amen. Right, I will leave you with our wonderful worship group, and Chris Llewellyn will bringing the sermon to us this morning.
Thank you. this cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all,
and I'm done. and love like mighty rivers, poured incessant from above, and there's peace and perfect justice, kiss the guilty world in love. Let me all thy love accepting, let me seek thy kingdom only, and my life be to thy grace. Thou alone shalt be my glory, nothing in the world I see. Thou hast blessed and sanctified me, thou thyself thou alone shall be my glory, nothing in the world I see. Thou hast cleansed and sanctified me, thou thyself hast set me free.
Well, hello again. Greetings from Gilwan in South East Wales, near the town of Abergavenny and also near the village of Crickhowell. Thank you once again for the opportunity to be able to share something from God's word, and we pray that God will bless you through this word, through the reading of the word and the understanding of the word, and pray that the Holy Spirit will take hold of this and apply it to our hearts and apply it to our lives. Our focus reading today is found in the book of Colossians and chapter 1. If you have a Bible to hand, that would be very good, because you can follow and check the verses, check the references. If you don't have a Bible, maybe you have it on a tablet, maybe you have it on your phone or some other means, but that doesn't matter, but it's important that we read God's word together. Just a little bit of background before we read. Here in the book of Colossians, Paul the Apostle is writing whilst he's in prison in Rome to the Christian believers in the city of Colossae. It was a church he had never visited. He knew some of the folk there, but he had heard that there were great problems there with false teachings and half-truths being taught. Various theological errors had been taught and had crept into the church. And Paul here writes in his letter both to correct these and also to encourage the believers to remain faithful to the true gospel. And so we read from Colossians chapter 1, and starting at verse 9. Paul writes, "For this reason also, since the day we heard this, we haven't stopped praying for you. We are asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, so that you may walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, bearing fruit in every good work, and growing in the knowledge of God. May you be strengthened with all power, according to his glorious might, for all endurance and patience, with joy, giving thanks to the Father, who has enabled you to share in the saints' inheritance in the light. He has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins." First, notice Paul's response to the Christians there. In verse 9, he says, "I have never stopped praying for you that you will be filled with the knowledge of Christ's will in all wisdom and understanding, so that you may walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him. That's important, isn't it? That we walk worthy of the Lord. That being a Christian is not just about joining the God Club, but it means a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And in when I was younger, I knew the things that pleased my father. I knew the things that displeased my father. And I tried to bring pleasure to my father through the sacrifices he had made through his hard work in the steelworks. And so we should live our lives as worship in response to what God has done for us, that the new life that we have in the Lord Jesus Christ, that we might walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him. So in real and practical terms, what does it mean to walk worthy of the Lord? Well, it's like this. As a member of the royal family, there's an expectation that you will live your life in a manner worthy of being a royal. There's a responsibility. As a British citizen, we have responsibilities to live our lives in certain ways. If you were a member of our family, or as a member of your family, there are responsibilities in the way in which you live your lives. As Christians and members of the family of God, there's an expectation that we will live our lives in a manner worthy of our new position in Christ. We are adopted into the family of God. Therefore, there are responsibilities that we need to live up to and express those in how we live our lives. The theologian J.I. Packer said that being a Christian is all about having a relationship with God through Christ. A relationship with God through Christ. And as in all relationships, there comes a responsibility. You and I have a responsibility to live our lives worthy of the calling that we've received and the position that we find ourselves in Christ. Well, what are these responsibilities? Paul outlines them here for us in verses 10 and 11. He says, walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, bearing fruit in every good work and growing in the knowledge of God, that you may be strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, for all endurance and patience with joy, giving thanks to the Father who has enabled you to share in the saints' inheritance in the light. Those responsibilities, let's briefly look at them. First of all, in verse 10. First of all, there's fruitful living. Once we were dead in our transgressions and sins, now we are alive in Christ. Things that are alive produce fruit. As we heard last week in the message, producing fruit in our lives is important. Things that are alive produce fruit. We should live in a fruitful way. The question is, are we bearing fruit for the gospel in our lives? Are we displaying the fruit of the Spirit as outlined in the book of Galatians? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faith, gentleness, and self-control. Are we displaying the love of God in the way we act and speak, pointing unbelievers to him? You see, fruit are not an end in themselves. Fruit produce the seed. And we pray that the seed of the gospel will take root in people's lives through us bearing that fruit, the seed of the gospel. People seeing Christ in us, in how we live our lives. But we must not forget that the gospel message is theological in its foundations, but ethical in its implications. It's theological in its foundations, ethical in its implications. Well, what does that mean? Micah 6, verse 8 tells us, it means living out the gospel in both word and deeds. James, in his book, says this, faith without works is dead. Faith without works is dead. It's no good professing a faith without it showing in your life. And that's important, and that's what Paul is saying here, that we bear fruit. We are fruitful in the way we live our lives for Christ. Secondly, it says, bearing fruit in good work and growing in the knowledge of God. It's knowledgeable living. Growing in the knowledge of God. Learning more about God. The more we learn of God through the Lord Jesus Christ, the more we will love him. The more we will want to please him. The Bible tells us all we need to know about our Heavenly Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So it's important for us to learn from the scriptures about him and his ways. As I've just said, the more we know, the more we will appreciate. We have the scriptures available to us in our own language. We need to discipline ourselves in a personal daily devotional Bible study, and also to meet with other Christians to systematically study together and to know more about him. It's personal and it's corporate. We read and study on our own, but it's important to get together with other Christians to learn. There are countless Christian books available. Some authors you can trust, but unfortunately there are others with superficial, attractive titles which can easily lead you astray. Ask a trusted Christian friend. Ask one of the leaders in the church for some recommendations. Also join with other Christians to regularly pray and worship together. Like any relationship, the Christian life, our relationship with God through the Lord Jesus Christ, is progressive and not a static state. Thirdly, in verse 11, Paul talks about powerful living, that you may be strengthened, he says, with all power. What is that power? That is the power of the Holy Spirit working in and through our lives, often giving us patience, often giving us joy. That it's not by might, nor by power, not through our own human strength, not through trying to improve ourselves, but allowing the Holy Spirit to work in and through our lives, to strengthen us to live for Christ. Living the Christian life is not about perspiration or determined self-effort or self-improvement, but the power of God working in and through us. When I was working and teaching in Pembrokeshire, I had a friend who was a violin teacher who lived up on the Ridgeway. You might have known him. He was a lover of garlic. And often when he had eaten garlic, which was nearly every day, he'd come into school and you'd meet with him. You could smell garlic on his breath. You could smell garlic on his skin. It was coming through his pores. It was coming out from him. The power of the Christian living is not in garlic, but it's the power of the Holy Spirit that permeates through us, that comes through us in our living, not by might or by power, but by God's Spirit. And Paul says here that we might be strengthened by all power according to his glorious might. That's the strength for Christian living, the Holy Spirit working in and through us. This gives us a surety, a steady persistence, knowing the power of God's grace working in and through us. The power of God's Holy Spirit constantly flowing through us. Not necessarily in an occasional surge or a dramatic experience or just a top-up on a Sunday, but a constant daily flow to live powerful lives for him, living by the Spirit of God. Fourthly, Paul talks about thankful living. In verse 12, he says, giving thanks to the Father. I'm thankful for my father, who worked in the steelworks, doing hard, physical, dangerous work to provide for us, to provide a way that we might not have to do that ourselves, to encourage us to work hard in school. But I'm thankful to God for what he has done for us in sending Jesus. Our lives need to be marked with thankful gratitude for what God has done for us in Christ. God owes us nothing, but we owe him everything. What he provides for us materially is nothing in comparison to what he has done for us spiritually. He has given us everlasting eternal life. God has shown his immense mercy and love for us by sending Jesus to pay the price for all our wrongdoings and all our sins. And he's qualified us to share in his wonderful inheritance in glory. Here, Paul says, he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and has transferred us into the kingdom of his Son, who he loves, that we might comprehend, that we might get some understanding of what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and know the love of Christ which surpasses knowledge. Truly, we should be thankful for that. Oh, that we would have an increasing awareness of the extent of God's love, God's mercy, God's chesed, God's favour towards us, and give our lives and live our lives as a response in thankfulness to him. Are we walking worthy? Are we walking worthy of the Lord? Are the things that Paul mentions here in Colossians chapter 1 woven into the fabric of our lives? Are these things that run through our lives in the way that we act, in the way that we think, in the way that we behave? Do our lives bring glory to him? Because it's not about us, it's all about him. And the four points that we've just touched on today. Do we have fruitful living? Are we bearing fruit for the gospel in our lives? Do we have knowledgeable living? Are we growing in the knowledge of the love of God, understanding more and more the depth of what he has done for us? Do we have powerful living? Are we living our lives in the power of the Holy Spirit and not in our own strength? And do we have thankful living? Giving thanks to God for all that he has done for us in the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's just pray for a moment. Let's just pause. Lord, we thank you for your word. We pray, Lord, that you will take hold of this word for us today, that you might challenge us to live our lives worthy of the calling that we have received in you, and that we might bring glory to the name of Jesus, that people might see you in us, that we might be faithful witnesses for you in the way that we live our lives. And we pray, Lord, that the glory will go to you. Because, Lord, it's not about us. It's about you. And we pray that we might live our lives in such a way that glory might be brought to the name of Jesus amongst the people we know, amongst our family and our friends, and all those people who live around us, that we might love you more and more and grow more and more in your grace. In the name of Jesus, we ask it. Amen.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me. And this is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me. Desperate for you.
Thank you to our worship group, and thank you to Chris for his message today. I'd just like to close with a passage from 1 Peter 5, verse 8 to 11. Just like to read this to you. Be well balanced and always alert, because your enemy, the devil, roams around incessantly like a roaring lion, looking for its prey to devour. Take a decisive stand against him and resist his every attack with strong, vigorous faith. For you know that your believing brothers and sisters around the world are experiencing the same kinds of troubles you endure. And then, after your brief suffering, the God of all loving grace, who has called you to share in his eternal glory in Christ, will personally and powerfully restore you and make you stronger than ever. Yes, he will set you firmly in place and build you up, and he has all the power needed to do this forever. If anybody would like to join us in prayer, and praying specifically for persecuted fellowships around the world, and for people who are suffering persecution, please don't hesitate to contact us on our Facebook page and join us. Okay, God bless all of you. Goodbye.